Hello, in this new video I'm going to talk about a subject which deals with nuclear fusion by magnetic confinement, and so it is strictly related with my job, so that the things that I study and in which I work. It is quite a technical, a very specific subject, which is the control and suppression of neoclassical tearing modes by electron cyclotron heating and current drive. So, which is this name, which sounds very complicated? I will explain what it means. So, basically, it deals with the control of some magneto-heterodynamic instabilities, which are deleterious for the plasma confinement, by using some particular electromagnetic waves. So, this subject joins together two topics which are very interesting for me and which I have worked, and which I find very interesting also for the physics point of view. So this is a practical technology, basically, because it has practical application. It is very important for the success of nuclear fusion reactors, but in particular for me it is interesting for the physics which is behind. So in this video I will try to explain you how it works, what is the physics which is behind these processes, and how it is implemented in practice. So I prepare some slides and I will show you them. Okay, so before I begin with the very subject of this talk, of this video, I have to remind some concepts concerning the nuclear fusion by magnetic confinement, which is the general framework in which this subject takes place. I realized some time ago a series of videos on nuclear fusion by magnetic confinement in Italian. So for those of you who speak Italian, who understand Italian, I will probably put a link to this series of lectures. Otherwise, I will just remind some basic concepts. So nuclear fusion by magnetic confinement is a technology which is trying, I mean, many scientists in the world and many laboratories are trying to implement for a, say, a green and sustainable energy production in the near future. So the technology consists in confining some hot plasma, which is a ionized gas, so made of electric charges and globally neutral. In particular, this is implemented in tokamaks, which are toroidal devices where a system of magnetic coils produce some magnetic field which contains the plasma. And so in these devices we have several magnetic fields and also electric currents which circulate. In particular, we have a toroidal current, which is indicated here by these arrows, which is induced by some magnetic flux variation. So there is a magnetic flux which is varied by changing the current in some central solenoid, a series of coils. When this current is induced in the plasma, this causes some heating because of ohmic heating, because of finite resistivity of the plasma, and so this provides already some heating for the plasma, which is necessary to trigger the nuclear reactions. However, this is not sufficient. In fact, for the physics which is involved in the plasma collision, basically resistivity decreases with temperature, which means that we cannot reach arbitrary high temperature with just ohmic heating. And for this we need additional heating, which has the purpose of increasing the temperature to the level which are required to trigger the fusion reactions. And for the additional heating systems, I have realized another video in the past, again in Italian, so only for those of you who speak and understand Italian, and I will put a link also to this in the description. So the additional heating is necessary to reach the conditions to trigger the nuclear reactions, and once the nuclear reactions are triggered, the heating is provided mainly by alpha particles, which are produced by the nuclear fusion reactors, and so at this point the reaction should be self-sustained. And this picture is the scheme of the coils and the currents and magnetic fields. And this is taken from the official ITER website. ITER is the International Experimental Tokamak Reactor, which is the largest project for nuclear fusion which is going on. Then we move to the first protagonist of this talk, this presentation, which is the electron cyclotron waves. So electron cyclotron waves are a kind of electromagnetic waves with high frequency. The frequency of these waves is a multiple of the electron cyclotron frequency, which is a characteristic frequency of the plasma. And these waves are generated by some devices, which are some electronic valves, vacuum tubes, which are called gyrotrons, which are able to provide up to 1 megawatt of power each, which is a very large amount of power. Then the power is transmitted along a very long transmission line, which is made typically by waveguides, and then it is launched in the plasma by some system of mirrors, which redirect the beam. So the electron cyclotron waves have the property of providing heating directly to the electrons. It is a sort of it is a resonant kind of absorption, so it is absorbed in exactly in the place where the wave frequency is equal to the local electron cyclotron frequency or a multiple. It is very localized because the deposition spot, the deposition region, is very narrow, which means that one can aim at very specific target inside the plasma, and it doesn't require an antenna inside the vessel, which saves a lot of troubles, and it only needs some open-ended waveguide with eventually some mirrors to redirect the beam. And it has multiple applications. In fact, it can be used to prevent impurity accumulation, which is one main issue in large devices, for example in ether. It can be used to provide additional heating to the plasma, and also to drive some current, which is not inductive. So it can be used to provide additional current to the plasma. And finally, it can be used to control and suppress the MHD instability, so magneto-hydrodynamics instabilities, for example, the magnetic islands. And this is the target, the main subject of this talk, so I will deal only with this part. This picture is the electron cyclotron system developed at W7X Stellarator in the north of Germany. Stellarator is a device which is similar to a tokamak. It is more complicated in the magnetic configuration, but the electron cyclotron system works exactly in the same way as the tokamak. In this particular system, they use mirrors instead of waveguides to propagate the wave to the plasma, but all the rest is exactly the same. So I told you that to redirect the beam into the plasma, to aim at different targets inside the plasma volume, one needs some mirrors that can be steered, so can be rotated, typically in both the poloidal and the toroidal directions, which are the main two angles in which which characterize the geometry of the tokamak. The poloidal steering, so the poloidal inclinations, is necessary to aim at different rational surface, which are the surface where the magnetic islands are developed, and so one has to target, so to adjust the inclination angle to direct the beam exactly in these positions. In fact, the magnetic islands are located on the rational surface, and later I will tell you more about these structures. And also, the experience has shown that the injection from an upper position, so not from the horizontal plane, from the mid port, let's say, but from an upper position, is optimal to cover the largest fraction of the plasma volume. This picture is taken from some publications from ITER, so they are designed for the launcher for ITER. And so this picture represents the waveguides which come to the launcher and the different mirrors that focus and then redirect the beam in the different positions. So the second ingredient, the second protagonist of this presentation, is magnetic islands. I have dedicated a live to this subject, again in Italian, so I will probably put a link also to this. To this video, for those of you who speak Italian, it covers many more aspects of this interesting subject. So, but to sum it up, the magnetic islands are an instability. In particular, they are the result of nonlinear evolution of Tering modes, which are a linear instability which develops in the plasma, and they are reconnected instabilities. In fact, they cause the magnetic reconnection of magnetic field lines, and they are located on the rational surface, which are particular position inside the plasma volume, which are critical for this kind of instability. I prefer not to enter too much in the physical description, but for the moment take this for granted. And to explain better why they are called magnetic islands, actually they are structures which are elongated in the direction of the magnetic field line, but they appear as islands or as eyes, for example, if you prefer, in the perpendicular plane, so in the plane perpendicular to the magnetic field. And the nonlinear evolution of the Terry modes, so the, of magnetic islands, is described by the Rutherford equation, which is a famous equation in plasma physics, which describes the evolution of the amplitude of these islands. Now, the title of this presentation was Control of Neoclassical Terry modes. So far I have just talked about Terry modes. So neoclassical Terry modes are somehow a different form of these instabilities, which are affected by toroidal geometry, so by toroidal effects. So the tokamak is a toroid, so it has the shape of a torus, and this toroidal geometry introduces some effects on the orbits of particles, and in particular it leads to the origin, let's say to the birth, of a class of particles which gets trapped in some particular regions of the tokamak, in orbits which are called banana orbits because of their shape as it is displayed here. And so we have a fraction of particles which are trapped in this somehow crescent-like orbits, and the friction between the trapped and the circulating particles leads to the originate some current, which is called bootstrap current. This is important because it can be a very significant fraction of the total plasma current, but it has also some relevant effect on the instability of these modes. In effect, the bootstrap current is proportional to the local pressure gradient, which means that the stronger the pressure gradient, the larger is this bootstrap current. But the presence of magnetic islands locally changes the pressure gradient because of transport effects. The magnetic islands tend to change the transport properties of the plasma, with the result that the pressure profile becomes locally flat inside the island, and so the fraction of bootstrap current which would be located here is removed. So we have a sort of hole in the bootstrap current, and this has destabilizing effect on the island. The result is that if we have some seed island, so an island which is created by some reason in the plasma, and it would be linearly stable, maybe because the equilibrium of the plasma is stable with respect to the Terry modes, this bootstrap current effect can make it non-linearly unstable, and this is called then a neoclassical Terry mode. So this is the kind of condition of the situation we are talking about. Now I talked about the Rutherford equation, which is the equation which describes the evolution of the island amplitude, so it tells you how the amplitude grows in time. And it is the equation which describes the nonlinear evolution of Terry modes, essentially. The island width is typically indicated by W, and so the Rutherford equation describes dW over dt, so the evolution of the amplitude in time. The original Rutherford equation only included the linear stability index, which is indicated by delta prime 0, which comes only from the equilibrium. If we include also the effect of bootstrap current, so the neoclassical effect, or toroidal effect if you prefer, the ion polarization current, which has a different origin which I do not explain here but it is important, and then the effect of additional heating and current drive which comes from the electron cyclotron waves, then we have a more general equation which is called the generalized Rutherford equation. And it is written here symbolically, so only in symbols. So we have the linear stability index, this term which comes from the modification of the linear stability index because of the current. We have the bootstrap contribution, which actually includes also the polarization current. Then we have the current drive contribution and also the heating, because this also affects the island stability. And so one purpose of this theory is to study how these terms balance in this equation. Here, just for information, so for to complete the picture, I provide you also some explicit formulas for these terms, which have been deduced in this thesis work, so stabilization of magnetic islands in tokamaks by localized heating and current drive by Diego De Lazzari. It's a PhD thesis, it's very well written. But I do not go into the details of these formulas. Just note that these are analytical formulas. For example, here, Fc, this function is the, let's say, the reciprocal error function or complementary error function. Actually, it is 1 minus the error function. And the error function is the integral of the Gauss function. As a function of the island width and the deposition width, which is the width, let's say, of the deposition region by the electron cyclotron waves. The linear stability index, delta prime, typically is the most difficult term to calculate, but here it is expressed in a very clever way as a function of the bootstrap contribution, the bootstrap term, at saturation, because of the consideration that when the island is saturated, basically the unstable contribution from the bootstrap current must be compensated by the stable contribution from the linear stability, which means that this term must be equal. And so this allows to calculate this term even without knowing the details of the equilibrium. Then we have an explicit expression for the bootstrap current contribution, which includes also the polarization term. And finally, the two important, most important terms, which are the effect of current drive and heating. As you see, they have almost identical shape. Here we have the total driven current. Here we have the current which is induced by heating, and they have similar origin. And then we have these two functions, FCD and FH, which are very complicated functions, which let's say describe the deposition efficiency. So basically, how the injection strategy for the wave is able to deposit the power very close to the island in a very narrow region. It is a function of this W star, which is the ratio between the island width and the deposition width, W dep. Then you have the X dep, which is the basically the disalignment, so how far the deposition region is from the rational surface. And then this capital D is basically the duty cycle in case the wave is not continuous, but it is pulsating, so it is modulated in frequency, which turns to be a useful solution. So all these terms together can be put in the equation, and then the relative size can be studied. So this basically, if the sum of all these terms is positive, the island is growing in time. If it is negative, it is not growing, it is decreasing in time, which means that it is stable. Actually, the marginal stability condition amounts to imposing that this term is equal to zero. So the sum of all these contributions is equal to zero. And so one can study the solutions on this equation. But first, one can make the things more simple. For example, one can introduce this f of w, which is defined as this combination of this function, which is the dependency on the amplitude of the island of the bootstrap term, bootstrap plus polarization term. And by using this, one can write this equation essentially in a more compact form in terms of the bootstrap current, JBS, this function, or better, this combination of functions, and then the current drive written here, and then which multiplies all again this function, which can be complicated. And to evaluate the efficiency of NTM stabilization, this quantity is introduced, which is the NTM suppression efficiency, which is defined as the ratio between the maximum current driven by the electron cyclotron waves and the local bootstrap current. So this is defined as in this way. In principle, the larger it is, the better it is, but in effect, even values which are order 1 are already quite good. And the maximum is calculated by maximizing this function, which is obtained by solving this equation, but maximizing it with respect to W, which is the island width. And the range in which this can change is between 0 and the saturation width. So this is calculation which is typically done numerically, because these functions are very complicated. So I will not show you the full description of how this actually works, how the solution changes. I will give you only some general results. In particular, so this NTM suppression efficiency depends on the deposition characteristics. So these are characteristics of the injected wave. So we have the deposition width of the wave, the displacement, so the deposition position minus the rotational surface. And then also depends on island characteristics, so you have the saturation width and the marginal width, which is basically the width of the island where the right hand side of the equation has its maximum. So it is a characteristic width of the island. And there is a general consideration, a general rule, which can be already deduced, and this is that the misalignment, which is this displacement from the position region and the rotational surface, must be smaller than the position width of the wave. Otherwise, most of the power will be deposited outside the island or too far from the island. Then much more specific conditions emerge if one solves the equation numerically, and this depends basically on this ratio, so the saturation width divided by the marginal width. And this can change significantly depending on the plasma conditions, and this discriminates between the large and small saturated islands. So the behavior is different in these regimes, and so one has to calculate this in different regimes. And I prefer also to show you this picture, which is a very explicative, very interesting picture taken from this publication by Marashek on nuclear fusion. This picture basically shows the stability, so this studies the stability of the generalized Rutherford equation in the plane determined by the variables dV over dt, so the time derivative of the width, versus V, so the island width. So if the curve is positive, it means that the right hand side is positive, and so the island is unstable. Vice versa, if it is negative, the island is stable. And the purpose typically is that of shifting this curve downwards and possibly make it always negative, so that the island is always stable. And this can be done in two ways. Since this instability terms can be written in terms of the plasma beta, which is the ratio between the plasma pressure and the magnetic field pressure, one can reduce the beta. So if one reduces the beta during a discharge, which is the case of this top case, of this top example, basically you go below some threshold, and at some point the island becomes stable because you shift all the curves downwards. Another way is to operate with electron cyclotron waves, and this was the strategy used in this other shot. So at some point some electron cyclotron power was switched on, and this had the effect of stabilizing the island again, and so at some point all the curve has shifted to negative values. And so this concludes basically the overview of this physics. So I hope that you enjoyed my attempt to describe this kind of physics, these processes which are involved in this strategy to control and suppress the neoclassical tearing modes. I think it is very interesting because this technology has evolved a lot in the decades, both from the theoretical point of view and from the experimental point of view. So the theory somehow have guided the improvements also in the technology. And now the very high efficiency, so NTM suppression efficiency, have been reached. And now I'm involved in the design of the ECRH system for a new tokamak. And so I have to study both the technological and also the physical aspects of the problem to be able to make predictions and to give reliable numbers to to help the final design of the system. So I think it is very interesting. I'm still not finished with it. I have still to make some further calculations, and then I will probably leave the more let's say quantitative calculations for the final design to the experts, and we will commission the design of the launcher, so which includes also the mirrors to deflect the beam and all the technical details which are more of technological character. So this is very interesting, very challenging, but also fascinating subject. So I hope that you enjoyed it, and see you in the next video. Bye bye.